Hi everyone, welcome to our class. So today we will discuss about Node.js and Express, but before we start doing that, let's actually finish HTML canvas that we started last time. So we actually want to discuss only one topic, one end topic, which is basically learn how to make games using nothing but HTML and JavaScript. So in order to make a game, start by creating a canvas for the game area and make it ready for drawing. And as you can see here, I'm creating an HTML document. I will put it in an into a game.html file. In this canvas, I'm basically, in this document, I'm basically on load of the body. I'm starting the game. The game will invoke the method start in my game object. My game area object has a method start that creates a canvas with a specified width and height of 480 pixels and 270 pixels. Then I'm getting the context of this canvas, the 2D context, and I'm inserting in the current document in the body before the current canvas, basically the as the first child of the document body, this canvas. If you want to see how this looks like, let's actually start it in VS Code. Let's add the current folder, JS examples. And this game, basically the standard canvas, just looks like an empty canvas. We just created this empty canvas for populating the game. So a few interesting things that you should notice in this example is that basically I'm invoking a method start game at the load of the body. So it's an event handler that the moment that this page loads, it will invoke the method start game. Another method that you, function that you should notice is the fact that for this object, for this method, function, start game, I'm getting my game area object that is variable that is defined below, and I'm invoking the start method for it. And in that start method, I'm inserting, the current canvas into the body of this, document. Next, we want to add a red square. Like in the homework that we have, we want to add squares on the grid for the snake or the worm, whatever you want to call it, and also objects or squares for, or circles for the food that these worms eat. So basically the same file that we had before with the addition that we are also adding the component to the current canvas. And this component basically has a width, a height, and an X and Y coordinate, start X and Y coordinate. And I'm getting the context for the current game area, and I'm filling the rectangle that I basically want to put in the in this object. So you can see that in the start game method, I'm not only creating the canvas with the start method, but also I'm creating the new component that is rendered in the current canvas. So this line is new in this code. Okay, so again, if I change this to a different new file, it basically will contain the same example as before, but also the red object in our game. Next, we want to update the game. So basically, a normal behavior for every game is that it displays 50 times per second, which is like much like the frames in a movie. 50, 60 frames per second is totally normal. And this is done in JavaScript with this function, setInterval, and what is the method that will be invoked and how often this will be invoked. In our case, this will be invoked every 20 milliseconds. So about 50, exactly 50 times in 1 second. So there are several functions that this update game area does. One is clearing the entire view. So basically this function clear will empty the canvas, will create a new rectangle that is completely clear with the entire width of the canvas and the entire height of the canvas at coordinates 0, 0, the upper left corner. It also invokes the method update, which basically updates the entire canvas. It's basically a function that updates the entire canvas. So let me show you this version of the game. So here is basically the new version that has update every 20 milliseconds. The function update basically redraws the entire canvas, the entire, gets the context of the canvas, fills the entire canvas, and then fills the rectangle that I basically want to move in my object. And if I run it again, basically we have, this is actually a figure that is drawn every 20 milliseconds, about 50 times per second. So we don't actually see any updates. This is done in real time. Okay. So now the next step is actually updating the game. So how do we implement game controllers? And we can implement game controllers in multiple ways. We can implement as key handlers or as actually buttons, which will invoke methods in our program. So in this case, basically move up, move down, move left, and move right are methods which are invoked when a user clicks on various buttons, up, left, right, and down. But even before that, I have another version of this program that the only thing that is a difference between this version and the previous version is that every 20 milliseconds, it moves a piece. So if we want animation, basically when we invoke this method update game area that updates the screen, the canvas all the time, we basically want also to update the positions of objects. So this is without interaction from the user, but basically what it does, it moves the object around a certain number of pixels, about 1 pixel per 20 milliseconds. Okay. And finally, the version that we have here in the slides, which basically allows us to control the object by pressing buttons up, left, right, and down, is the next version of the game, which basically allows us to move objects at different locations in our game. Okay. So it basically lets us modify the objects in our game. So move up, for instance, decreases the speed on the Y coordinates with 1 pixel per round, basically every 20 milliseconds. Move down, increases the speed because the Y coordinate is from up to down with 1 pixel per round. And similarly for move left, decreases with 1, and move right, increases with 1. So this is a good start for your homework 3, which currently is due 2 weeks from now on October 9th, actually less than 2 weeks. I will probably increase the date with a week. But in this assignment, you have to implement the classical snake or worm game, but with the Stony Brook University scheme. So the rules of the game are quite similar to the standard worm game or snake game. You basically start with a worm of size 1, and you start moving on the screen. Every 20 milliseconds, it basically goes in the current direction. The difference that makes it a Stony Brook team is that the objects that it eats are courses, like CSC 114 or other courses. You start with a predefined grid of 36 by 21 squares. Moving up, the worm moves up. Every 0.5 seconds, the snake moves forward in the current direction with exactly 1 cell in the grid. The goal of the game is to eat all of the CSC classes from the list of classes that we had in homework 2. You generate these classes randomly from that list, basically choose one object at a time from the list without duplicates. Every time the snake eats another class, it grows with one square. So it becomes progressively more difficult because, as you can see here, you can eat a lot of classes. You should be able to control the snake with keys up, down, left, right. The player loses the game when the snake runs into a screen border or itself, and the player wins the moment that all the classes were eaten. And you only have to play one round. If you want actually to see the game in action, you can basically try the Google version of this game, which basically it's similar to what we have to do, but as you can see. Any questions?
Really quickly, is the height and width include the border around it, or is it only inside?
Only inside, Connor.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome. Any other questions? There are a few questions in the chat. If we crank the frames higher, will it cause problems? Not that I know of. Basically, if you can set the interval up to 1 millisecond, I do not think that there is any lag. It will just speed up the entire game quite a lot. So let's change the set interval to, let's say, every millisecond. It will not have a problem with updates, but it will be quite fast. So that's it. How much frames our game should be? So every 0.5 seconds, it basically means 2 frames per second. So basically every half a second, your interval should update. So about 500 should be milliseconds, the update. But you should move with an entire cell. So it's not going to move smoothly. This is not a game that you have to move smoothly. How much frames should our game should be? I think I just responded to that. Don't some call get skipped if the program can handle each call in the interval it has? I don't think so. Basically, we are not quite doing event programming here. All that we actually are modifying is you are clicking on the buttons up, down, left, right. So actually what's happening is drawing every second, every half a second, the object, or in this case, every 20 milliseconds, the object. So your interaction with the buttons is quite slow with respect to the update of the canvas. Okay, good. So now let's proceed to our topic of the class today, which is Node.js and Express. So it's basically first time that we talk about server-side scripting. Okay. So Node.js originated in 2009. The original author was Ryan Dahl. It's an open source server environment, which basically means that it lets developers use JavaScript to write command line tools like scripting to scripts and server-side scripting to basically respond to requests from clients. It runs on various platforms, macOS, Windows, Linux, or any version of Unix. It's based on the Chrome V8 engine. Basically, Chrome V8 engine was released in 2006. It's written completely in C++. And V8, it compiles JavaScript source code to native machine code at runtime. It was basically the first compiler for JavaScript into bytecode that gets executed extremely fast. As of 2016, it also includes an interpreter, a bytecode interpreter. The stable release for Node.js, Node.js is now, it's continuously updated by the Node.js Foundation. The original author actually left the project in 2012 and actually created another project recently, very recently, for TypeScript. Basically, the JavaScript that is more typed, developed by Microsoft originally, and he's now developing something similar called Dino to Node.js, but for TypeScript. The current stable release for Node.js is 14.11.0, released on September 15th, 2020, about 4 days ago. The capabilities are similar to any server-side scripting language. Like PHP, it generates dynamically page content. So basically, you write a program that executes and generates HTML code that is sent to the user. It creates, can open, read, write files on the server, exactly like PHP or Java. It can collect the data, the form data that the user submits, and it can add, modify, and delete data from a database, which are topics that we will talk about later this semester. To install Node.js, you basically have to go to this website, node.js.org, and download basically the version of Node that you want to use on your machine. So most of you will probably have a 64-bit architecture. You will download probably for Windows MSI 64-bit, and similarly for other operating systems. You start the installer, and on my machine, basically, proposes first where is the location where it will be installed. My machine, it's installed it in C, program files, Node.js. It asks you what packages to be installed. Node.js runtime is the runtime that you will run with basically in the command prompt, like Node. And basically, this is the runtime. You should also install the package manager, NPM. We'll talk a little bit more about this. It was released about 2 years after Node was released in 2011. And basically, it's an easy manager for lots of packages. Node.js has about 1,000 packages, and you can easily install packages with NPM install and the package that you want to install. The online documentation shortcuts, you can also download and add it to the path. So the advantage of adding it to the path is that if you run command line and you run Node, it basically it's available in the path. To exit, you press Control C twice. So next question is if you want to install native modules. These are basically modules that lets you compile modules on your own machine. You shouldn't really do this. I mean, I doubt that you will actually develop Node modules yourself. So in most cases, these are already compiled and available in binary when you download them with NPM. So once you are done with these settings, you're ready to install Node.js. And after a while, after about 5 minutes on my machine, it installed Node.js. In order to test if it really worked, start your command line and try to run Node, which basically will start the, like in Python, an interpreter for Node. Now, you should also try to install, to start it for VS Code. So let me show you how to do this. Actually, I already had VS Code started. So let me start it here. So I'm closing all my files. So first thing that you should do is to start the terminal in Node.js to basically find the terminal and start it in Node.js. So right here, I have new terminal. By default, on my machine, it starts PowerShell. but I will create a JavaScript debug terminal, which basically it's I'm going to use Node for various applications. Okay. Good. So we will run the files directly from the terminal in the Visual Studio Code. So there are a few differences between Node.js and JavaScript. You have to know about them, but we'll only use them later. So one of them is that there is no window or document object, because basically there is no DOM. So window is the current browser properties. Like for instance, you can set the timeout, the interval that we saw in HTML canvas, that a function is called for the current browser. And that's window. Document is the current document, the DOM file. Node.js doesn't have a default document or window, has a global scope. So when you learn about principles of programming languages, one thing that you will learn about is scoping rules and binding and scoping for programming languages. And basically for Node.js, you have a global scope. All the objects are global objects and they will be available for the entire Node.js environment. So all of these methods, set timeout, clear timeout, set interval, clear interval, work for the entire environment. It's for the global scope. In JavaScript, for instance, in a browser, you can set properties for a specific window, like set interval is basically going to be in window.set interval. So it's a property for the browser itself. But for Node.js, when you run set interval, is global.set interval, is for the entire global environment. So not much about that, but basically the concept of modules is important for Node.js. Each file is a module. And if you want to use variables or functions from inside the file, they need to be exported to be available in other files. And here we have an example, logger.js is basically a JavaScript file that defines a variable URL that is www.cs.stonybrook.edu. I define a function log that takes a message and logs that message in the console. And I'm exporting both the log and the endpoint. So module.export.log will be the log. So this is a name that will represent for those that require this logger module, the log. And endpoint is basically the outside variable, external variable that will be exported for that is equal with the URL. So as you can see, it's not always the case that you have to export a function with its real name inside your function, inside your module. You can export it with a different name. App.js is a separate file that require logger. So basically it loads that module that we defined before and we invoke the method log. So logger.log passes the message hi Paul to the log function and the log function basically logs it in the console. Similarly, logger.log, logger.endpoint will basically take the endpoint, which is the URL that we defined before, and it will call the method log on that URL. So it will have the same output that it basically outputs the URL that we had here. So let me show you these two. So I already wrote them in JavaScript. So logger.js is basically the first file that defines URL and log and exports them as log and endpoint. And app.js is the second one that first of all, it loads this function require, loads a module, either that is one of the default module, 1000 modules in node.js or the one that we defined before with the name logger.js. And it uses functions from that logger.js. So basically the module is loaded into the logger variable. You can change this name. It basically is not linked in any way with the name of the class that you loaded, the module that you loaded, but it's customary that you use the same name. So for that new module that you loaded, I invoked logged of high poll and logger the endpoint that was basically our website. So in order to run it, you run node app.js, and here you can see the output. So it basically it logged in the console both our outputs, high poll and our website. So it basically worked exactly as we expected. And you can also run it in command line exactly as we are doing it here. It's really a server-side scripting. By the way, at any time you want, you can ask questions. Node.js has a large number of modules, of built-in modules. It's actually thousands that perform common tasks. A few of them that you are going to use or you should know about are the following. DNS. So the names that we are using to access various websites are called domain name servers, and they are not the actual address of these servers. So probably you already learned about this in CSC 3.10, but just to know about it, you basically, the names that you are using to access various web servers on the web are not actually the addresses of those servers. The IP address is a specific in V4 or V6 is a specific format with numbers. So usually you have four numbers, four bytes separated by commas, and that would be an IPv4 address. The DNS module does this conversion. It basically allows you to use DNS names where you want to connect to a server, and it translates from DNS to IP. And if you ever want to see the real IP of a certain server, you can use ping, and then you can try various servers like google.com, and that will give us, in this case, the address of that server. And you can use them, you can interchange them. So for instance, I can copy it, and instead of going to a website to find google.com, I'm going to go to that IP address. And it actually is the website for the entry point for google.com. You can also find your own IP address. I believe on Windows is ipconfig. And one of the addresses here is probably my IP address, probably this address. So these are common things in networking. Crypto are libraries for performing cryptographic operations, encryption, decryption of documents, signing documents. All of these operations are done over a C library called OpenSSL, which is standard for Linux encryption. DGRAM implements UDP datagram sockets. So probably you also know this from CSC 3.10. TCP and UDP are the main protocols used for exchanging objects over the internet. TCP, it's a heavier protocol that requires acknowledgement for every package. UDP makes no guarantees that any package reaches the destination, or the order of the packages is the same as they were sent from the server. So DGRAM is basically a module in Node.js that allows us to actually send objects through UDP instead of TCP and request objects through UDP. Event implements events for server-side JavaScript. We'll talk about this actually today. FS supports file system operations like loading a file, reading from a file, creating new files. HTTP allows Node.js to act as an HTTP server. We'll actually use this again today. HTTPS allows a Node.js to act as a secure web server. So it uses encryption. OS provides information about the operating system. Path handles file paths. You can extract basically the current directory, the file name, and so on from paths. Query strings handles URL query strings, and we'll also discuss about this today, how it parses a query request, and it basically, you can obtain the query object or the URL out of a request. URL parses URL strings. And these are really a few packages, though there are thousands that are developed all the time in Node.js. Many of you haven't taken 3.10, but probably you don't need it at this point. I saw this question in the chat. You basically will not use that material except basically building a basic web application. We'll discuss, I will probably create a small lecture on basic networking, but you don't need too much to know. You will take, it's a required course in the major anyway. Okay, so now how to create a simple web server. So basically you require the HTTP pack, module. You create for in that HTTP module a new server. A server basically gets a request and sends back a response. And these are variables in this function. JavaScript basically, you can write to a variable that you get as a parameter, and you can read from a variable that you get as a parameter. In this example, I'm actually going just to use response. So I'm going to write into the response. 200 means good. So basically it's the status for everything went well. 400 is the status that everything failed, like an error status would be 400. The content type that will be written in the response that is sent back to the client is text, and more specifically is HTML. And we end the response with actually a message, hello world. You can, there are multiple functions that you can write into the response. You can also download files in the response and so on. But basically, end is the function that ends the response process. Once we create the server, we can make it listen on a certain port number. So in most general cases, the standard port number that you write to is 80. That's the HTTP protocol port number. And then you don't need to specify the port number. 8080 was used since Java for development applications. So once you have these five lines of code in this demo.js file, you can start the server by typing into the console node demo server.js, the name of our file, and then open localhost colon 8080 in your browser. And it opens basically something like this. You just created a simple web application, a dynamic web page, where you ask the server, give me a web page, and it creates it on the fly. So let's actually see this example. So demo server, it's basically a simple example that first loads the module HTTP, and then for a request, it responds back, it creates a server, and it sends back hello world and listens on port 8080. So on our server, we run node demo server.js. And now it's waiting for us to open a browser. And let's use this window localhost 8080. And it basically loaded the page hello world.
Wait, Professor, I have a question.
Go ahead.
Can you like send a HTML page back instead of just saying hello world?
What you are sending back is HTML. So for instance, if I put here a tag like paragraph or break, this will be basically updated. Actually, let me restart the server. And now refresh this page, and you see that you have a bunch of new lines. So what you are sending here is HTML. I'm setting that the output, the content that will be written back to the response, is HTML.
Thank you.
So I saw already that somebody got errors, and really that's an error that you get when you basically don't respond to the correct request. We will get them in a couple of seconds, don't worry about it. Good. So what did we do? Basically the first thing that we did, we loaded the module HTTP. That loaded the HTTP module into a variable HTTP. Then after we got the module, we created a server. It creates a simple web server with two arguments in that function. The request, which is an object holding the incoming request, the entire full URL, and the query string that needs to be parsed. And the response, which is basically the response object that is the object that we will use to collect the data for the response. So you can see basically that both the input and the output are arguments to this function. And in this response, you can basically write with the write method, you can end, which ends the response process. You can send the JSON response back. You can actually send a download file, so response.downloaded will basically send the file back, and so on. So these are all types of response that you can give back to the user. Now, there are also events handled, and within the event module, basically the event module supports emitting and catching events, like for instance, a file is open. We will see an example where we add the handler to a file. When somebody opens the file, we will actually capture that event. Often this event class is a subclass by an application to add functionality to this emit and on mechanism to emit events and catch events. The URL. So let's return back to that simple application where we had the request object. So the request object in that create server function contains the URL in the member.url. So basically request.url gives us the URL for that page that was basically requested and loaded. We can parse that URL. So url.parse and then the request URL true basically returns back the entire query object, and this query object contains members itself. The host member, which is the host name. If you pass localhost, you will get null because really the localhost is the current machine. The path name is the path, it's the after the first slash, basically, let's say that you have localhost /members or API /members and so on. So everything from the first slash to the end of the path is basically the path name. Search holds the search parameters. So if you have question mark and then some search parameters, ID equal one and email equal pfodor@cs and so on, that is basically the search parameters. Query returns a structure of the search parameters, basically the name and value for every search parameter. And we will see a simple example. So in the second example that I have in the lecture notes, I'm basically getting the module HTTP and URL for parsing. I'm creating a server and then the response will basically have HTML code. Q is the query, so is the result of url.parse, the URL, the request.url. So basically I extract first the URL from the request and then I parse it. And then I assign that to the variable Q, and Q.host is the host name. Q.path name is the path. Q.search is the search queries. and q.path name is actually the path again. And then I basically log the query and I start breaking the query into pieces. So qdata is the query and I extract qdata.month for the month and qdata.year for the year. So if I send a request like this one, localhost 8080 mystring parser.html question mark year equal 2019 and month equals September, it will basically show me in the page something like this, that the local host is null, that basically the host is, I'm on the local machine. The path is mystring parser.htm, the name of my path. The query is year is 2019, month is September. The month that will be parsed out of that query is September and the year is 2019. So let me show you this example. This is this other demo server too. Let's stop the previous server and run demo server two. And let's query for this query. So this is a GET request and it basically sends all the query as a web request to the server. And it basically extracted everything that we had in that code. It extracted the host, the path name, the query, and then from the query it parsed the month and the year properties. Okay. We will actually learn more about routing in a few minutes, but before that, let's also learn the file system module. So Node.js has another module for writing, creating, and deleting files. And this is called the FS module. So here I have an example. The FS module is going to be used in a server that reads a file. So when I create back the response to the request from the server, I'm reading the file demo file 1.html, which is the simple file that I have below, an HTML file that has only a body. And then if this reading of the file was correct, I'm writing back the result in the head in the response. So the responses have actually two parts. They have a head, which is not the HTML head, but is basically the type of the response that is sent back. So in our case, it's a successful 200 is success response. And the response will be text HTML. I'm writing the entire file that I read. So basically this data was the file that was read from demo file 1.html. I'm writing it back in the response and I'm ending the response. And then I'm listening on port 8080 again for any request that the user may have. So basically what this program will do, we'll read this demo file one and send it back to the client, to the user. So let me show you this example. So demo file three. I'm going to start it in Node. And as I said, it basically reads the file and it sends back the response. So no matter what you send as a query, it will basically read the same file and compose back the result. So there is no, you don't do anything with a request. You only create back a response to that request. All the programs that you find in the lecture notes, you can just run them in Node.js. Okay, NPM. So let me see if there are any questions by now, nothing new.
Can I ask a quick question?
Go ahead.
So I haven't taken 3.10, so maybe I'm missing something, but if we put that code in like the, in a script tag in just a regular HTML file, it's not going to do anything, right?
So from the point of view of the networking, the same thing happens. This file will, so if you are asking for, in fact, So if you are asking on the current server, give me the demo, what the name is, demo file 1.html. In this case, nothing will happen because actually should have nothing, should have happened because actually it does, because you are in the current folder. So it basically you are ask, it's a static web server. You are asking for an HTML file and that is sent back. But in this, what I'm doing extra here, I'm creating the response back. So I'm reading that file and I'm putting, I can put more data if I want in that file, in the response I can put. In addition to this, also the response should contain, really basically you're building, you're writing a program that generates the response that will be sent back to the user, to the client.
So, okay, so what if we just take that code there and say, just create a new HTML file and just put it in like the head in like script tags and just open that in a web browser, what would happen?
Again?
So like if we just create a new HTML file, just completely blank, and we put that code in the, in like script tags, the code above the JavaScript.
These modules are not on the, in the browser.
So, okay.
So that's the first problem. But let's say that we also pass them from the server. The client that cannot access files directly on the browser, on the server. Mm-hmm. So this will not be possible to do on the client. And then you can, you can modify the DOM, but you cannot just write in the response. So really everything that is here is code that is written on the server. It's like you write C code to generate a response that is sent back to the user. Really, the browser, only thing that it sees is HTML and JavaScript that runs on the browser. This is JavaScript that runs on the server. So most, until 2009, all server code was written basically in other programming languages like Java or C or Python. But really what happened in 2009 is that Ryan came up with an idea, let's use JavaScript for on the server. And really it was quite novel that nobody would have thought that JavaScript can be used as a scripting language on the server. And it probably that's where this problem of this, I would say, question comes, that now we are running JavaScript also on the server? And the answer is yes, we do. As you can see, we are running a different kind of JavaScript on the server, but it's really, we are using it as a scripting language.
Okay, so really we should think of them as two different languages for two different purposes.
Yes.
Okay.
One is to update the DOM on the client, what we learned up to now, JavaScript and DOM and jQuery. And one is to actually implement a server-side application that responds to requests.
Okay, that makes more sense. Thank you.
Welcome. Okay, so npm is the package manager for Node. And it's really not something new. From the beginning of programming languages, there were package managers like pip for Python. And apt-get for basically Ubuntu-based or Debian-based Linux. NPM is the package manager. It's part of the Node installation. When we installed Node, you saw that NPM is the package manager. It's used to install supplemental software packages. Like for instance, if you want to install crypto, you would write npm install crypto. You can basically I think I already installed it, or now it's part of the default NPM. But if I do NPM install a new package that is not on my machine, like for instance, crypto, it will go to the server and try to download crypto. So it's really a package manager that brings new modules that you didn't have before on your machine. One thing to be careful about is that wherever you install a new package, it will also create NPM module packages, a new subfolder, which contains all the packages that you brought and you used. And normally you shouldn't, when you give me a homework or give somebody a program, you shouldn't include node-packages. Because as I said, there are thousands of packages and who knows what you installed, which are not used in your application. So basically, when you do a distribution, don't include packages that, or don't include packages at all, because we know in general what packages you actually use. So you don't need to install to give us also the packages. Once you have these packages with NPM, you basically can use them in applications with the require method that we saw before. Okay, so handling of events. So for instance, we also want to display in the console that the file that we created, that we used, was open. So you can attach a handler. The on operation was the one that we had before for attaching a handler to a certain object, that an operation happened on that object. So in this case, if the file is opened and we are going to open this file in the demo, you basically, we want to log in the console that that file was open. So it's like a handler, an event handler for objects or events in Node.js. And here I have a simple example. It's exactly the same example that I had before, that I'm reading a file, demo file one, and I'm passing it back as the response to the user. But in addition to that, I'm adding basically an event handler. So if that file is open, which is open the moment that you are actually creating the server, it actually outputs in the console that file was also open. So it's really a way to attach a handler to any object. And is used not only for logging, but you can use it for any kind of method that you want to be invoked. So this example I also have. It's actually the current example that I was running. And the only difference, as I said with before, is that is this, that I'm attaching a handler that the moment that I'm starting the server, it will print out in the console that the file was also open. So it's an event handler in Node.js. Express. So in most cases, you will basically see web architectures like MIN, that basically have these letters, acronyms for an entire stack of applications in a full stack web application. MIN stands for Mongo, Node.js, Express, or .js, or simply Express, and Angular. And really, we learned about Node, and we'll learn now about Express. In one of the future language classes, we'll learn about Node, Mongo, and Angular. So Express.js, or simply Express, is a web application framework for Node.js. So Node.js is basically an interpreter for JavaScript on a computer. Express is the web application framework, the one that it can do not only create a standard server, but do routing for you. So routing basically means that you respond to certain requests differently based on the URL that you are getting, the method that it's that you get, and so on. The initial release was in 2010 and is the default web application framework for Node. You can, once Node is installed, usually Express comes by default as one of the default packages. But if you didn't have them or you have an older version of Node, npm installed Express will install Express also as a module. And here is a simple example. So for instance, you have an index.js or app.js is the standard entry point for your application in the folder that you created. And you add the following. You first create an Express variable that is the Express module. And then you create an object, Express object in the app variable or constant. Then you start route this application. So for the default path, I basically, this is the response that I'm returning back. And you can have any other routes in your application. You can respond to members, you can respond to books, to birds and so on. So basically you define what happens for different paths in requests to your application. And then you define on what port usually you run it. And usually we run it on port 3000. And then you start listen to that on that port. And this is really a Lambda expression that basically says that the moment that you start listening on the port, the output will, the what will happen is that your printing server started on the console. So now on the on from some browser, if you go to the empty path DNS, it will basically return hello world, our response that we sent back. So let me actually show you this example. I believe that I have it in a different folder. So let me open Express example one. Okay. And let me close all the previous editors. Close all. Okay. So this is the first example. Basically, I'm creating an Express object. And for the default path, I'm returning back hello world. If I want to have other paths, I can add them here. So a different route would be if somebody is asking for members, then I'm basically returning back hello members. Okay. And the same, you can have as many routes as you want on your machine. You can also put IDs. We will see how to do that and respond based on those IDs. So now let's run Node again on app.js. I'm in the wrong directory. So let's go up. Let's go to Express and run Node on app.js. And now the server is waiting. And again, if I basically go to the default route, I get an error. And let's see why is that. Actually,
port 3000.
Yes, exactly. We noticed at the same time. But basically on port 3000, it responds hello world. And if I ask for members, it responds hello members. So this is a simple routing that it routes on different paths. Any questions about Express up to this simple example? Okay, good. So you can basically set and multiple routes. Moreover, you can also support multiple HTTP methods. So by default, when you ask for a resource, you ask with GET. And that's what happens when you put a URL in your browser. You get a GET request. But from forms, you can basically also make POST and PUT and DELETE requests. So the different type of HTTP method that will be called on the web server, it depends on what you are actually putting as the method that will be used in your form. And in RESTful interfaces, Get stands for retrieving resources, post for creating new resources, put for updating existing resources, and delete for deleting resources. There is also info, which basically usually returns info about the server. So now based on the method that you are using, now all that you need to do is for your Express application, specify the method, the path for which you want to route, and then the handler function. So basically for the input, for the default path, you get the request and the response. And what you have is code to handle that GET request. You can parse the request and compose the result, the response that is sent back to the requester. The path may also include parameters. So you precede the field with colon and then the variable that you are going to use for parsing that parameter. And I will show you a simple example in an actual application. So let's assume that we have defined on the server an array of members. And this is an array in JavaScript that says that members are multiple members, ID 1, Paul Fodor, P Fodor at CS, status active, and other members, Kevin McDonald's and Richard McKenna and so on. So you have an array that is hard-coded. A real application would use this from a database, but really what we want is to write an example and later we'll learn about databases. Now, let's assume that I want the entire array of members. So I create a GET route, and for this GET, if the members are requested, I transform that array of member objects, which is just a pure array of objects in JavaScript, into a JSON object that is sent back as part of the response to the requester. If you want to test the entire program, here is the program. I basically request the Express module, then app is the Express object. My array members contains two objects, ID 1, Paul Fodor, P Fodor at CS, ID 2, Kevin McDonald's, KTM at CS. Then the API, then the for the path API members, it basically sends back the JSON for the members of this club. And again, I'm setting the port number and I'm listening on the port 3000. If you try to query from your browser for API members, you will get back that array of objects in JSON. So this is my second object, which creates that example that creates those objects. And again, I'm going to run node app2. And now from a server, I want all the members in this array. So it returns back the members of my club. There were some questions in the chat. So let's go over those. Express is a module. Node.js is a server script, a scripting programming interpreter. Express is a module that does web routing. So as you saw in the previous in Node.js, you are able to create a server, but you don't have any framework for routing in that server. So Express is to actually do routing for you. Can you parse CSV into JSON? I'm sure that there is a module in Node.js to parse CSV. Can you just pass it? I don't think so. CSV is comma or tab separated, and JSON is not quite that. So that responds to those questions. Good. So now let's assume that we want a certain person with an ID. So I don't want the entire array of people, Paul and Kevin and so on, but I want the person with ID 1. So this is another routing that I'm adding another level, and under that level, I basically use ID 1. So the path now includes a parameter, and that parameter is basically a value that is passed from the user, but we are going to parse it into a variable that is used in our program. And it's really, we are using a lot of functional programming here. So first thing that I'm going to do is to invoke a function sum. Sum is inspired from Python sum function that takes for every member, this is an aggregate over that collection members, that for every member, it looks if it's true the fact that the ID of the member is equal with the integer, the parsing into an integer of the request.parameters.id. So what I'm basically looking for these members is if there exists any member whose ID is the same with the ID passed as a part of the path in that path. If that is true, then I'm composing back the result. And the result is the response.json of members.filter. So now it's another example of functional programming, which filters from the array of members only those members whose ID is equal with the ID that was passed as a parameter. In case that we didn't find any object whose ID was the one that was passed as a parameter, we return back an error. 400 is an error status, is the main error status. And we are returning back also a JSON object that states that no member with that given ID. And here I'm using the request.parameters.id was found in the result. Okay, so let me show you exactly this program. So the first part of the program is really identical. I'm showing you here in the log the fact that it will log true that yes, there is a member whose ID is equal with one. The second part is the interesting part. So here is we are getting a number as in the path, like for instance, one. And it responds back with this object that is created. First, it defines the constant found. The constant found is true if there exists a member in my path whose ID, a member whose ID is the ID that was passed as a parameter. If that is true, then I'm creating a response back of those members filtered on for all of those that the ID is equal with the parameter that was sent as an ID. Otherwise, I'm returning back an error. And let me show you an example. So this is my third app, which basically adds the ID here as a different path. And run the third one. So now in my browser, if I'm requesting for members whose ID is one, it will return Paul. I'm requesting for members whose ID is two, it returns Kevin. And if I'm asking for members whose ID is three, there is no such member. So it returns that there is no member with ID three. So depending on what we are passing, it basically responds with a filtered result on that ID. And all of these are really functional programming that for some members, and now we are passing a function, which basically states that for every member, I'm checking if it's true that the ID is equal with the ID passed as a parameter. And filter does exactly the same for every member in my collection. It runs this aggregate that it looks for those members whose ID is equal with the ID passed as a parameter. Triple equal versus double equal is basically double equal is type sensitive as Nikhil, is not type sensitive as Nikhil says, while triple equal is not type sensitive, double equal is. Good. Thank you, Nikhil. Good. So now more than get requests. You can also respond to post requests, put requests, which are basically doing different updates. And next time we'll actually deal with forms where you basically respond with a different function based on basically what the response is. And that's the topic of the class today. What I want you up to next class is basically to try to install Node and develop your first simple web application. That's all for today. Let's see if there are any other questions. Okay, no, not in general. So let's stop the recording.